So we spoke to some of the leaders in the municipalities, the mayors and these things, and sort of representatives. And we asked them, what are the real needs in the community? And one area that really stuck out as a major need was loneliness.
In Sortland, Norway, loneliness is a key challenge among both the elderly and the young. About one-third of the teenagers here say they feel lonely.
So this is why we started thinking, well, what can we as a church do to contribute and meet that need? We're trying and failing and seeing what works, what doesn't work, and through that learning. They don't necessarily know the name of God and who He is, but a lot of people do believe there is a God. And so belief in God is quite typical, at the same time as traditional church is seen as problematic in regard to the core cultural values. This region was one of the key areas for Adventism in Norway. We had areas here with the highest density of Adventists in all of Norway. And now our churches are very much dying.
Similar to many places around the world, the church has lost its foothold, struggling to be known as an integral part of the community. Can the church still be relevant here in Sortland? Pastor Kenneth believes so. The key is forming connections where people are and meeting their most painful needs.
The family structures is sort of something also this under attack in this region. So a lot of unstable family relationships. So we had a family retreat recently. We wanted to place a focus upon families spending time together. So that was the overall goal, strengthening family bonds.
Over the 6 days of the retreat, the eight families focused on spending wholesome time together. Organized activities like crafts and games provided opportunities for bonding and a lot of laughter and smiles.
It was very positive. It was very encouraging. They were so grateful because these families were also families that couldn't afford vacation themselves. So this was part of it. Also, we were offering them a vacation experience and they were just so grateful for that experience. And friendships building over that week we spent together was, so it was a very encouraging time. It has been sort of quite touching also seeing how God has been opening doors that we did not expect. When they see we as a church really wanting the best for the community, so they've given access where we can sort of be quite bold and open about faith. And it's received quite well as well. So I think this is not something we've been doing, but it's seeing how God is working on the lives of people and the hearts of people and opening doors that seemed very closed.
Please pray for church members in Sortland, Norway. Pray that God uses them to overcome the challenges of loneliness, broken families, and skepticism in the community, and that through this, people can come to know Jesus personally. This quarter, a portion of your 13 Sabbath offering will help build a center of influence for Pastor Kenneth and the church members to host programs and events geared toward the community. The offering will also help construct an urban center of influence in Cyprus and establish a church in Serbia. Please consider how you can support these projects through prayer and by giving to this offering.
Good morning, and welcome to the Vallejo Drive Sabbath School Lesson Study. As we begin our study, let's start with a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the love that you give to us, the scriptures that we have that mirror your character for us, and for the privilege that we have to have a Bible in front of us that we can study. I ask that you be with all of us as we study together. Be with those that are at home. If anyone is ill, I ask that you bring them back to health. And most importantly, dear Lord, please send the Holy Spirit so that I can read what you have for us in our lesson study for your honor and glory. In your name we pray, amen. This quarter, we've been studying how to interpret the scripture. As Seventh-day Adventists, we accept sola scriptura. The Bible alone is a conviction born out of the Protestant Reformation. It is the authoritative foundation of the truth that we believe and proclaim to the world. There's no other book like the Bible. As Peter describes it, prophets, though human, spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Paul writes in 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is God-breathed. As I was preparing for this lesson, I came to a conclusion that the Bible is another example of God's character by connecting his divinity with humanity. It is his message, even though it is expressed through human writers, but they were completely under his guidance. This message is for all of us. Why did God give us the Bible? He wanted us to know him as creator, as he revealed himself to men and women, and ultimately by sending Jesus as the exact representation of his character. John, my favorite author, writes, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind." Jesus is the center of the Bible all the way from Genesis to Revelation. The Old Testament points forward to his coming, and in his life and ministry, we see God revealed himself through Christ to us. In the Sabbath portion of the Sabbath School lesson, that is found in page 104, we see that the exposition of scripture is not just an intellectual exercise. We can have a lot of knowledge, we can study different versions, we can spend a lot of time learning languages so that we can be very knowledgeable about the Bible. But the goal of any study of the Bible is more than acquiring head knowledge. The truths of Scripture want to be lived, not just believed. Such a response to the biblical message is possible only through the transforming work of the Holy Spirit, who brings the word of scriptures to new life. He kindles the desire in us to embrace the truths of scripture and follow them with heart and mind, resulting in heart transformation, not just outward conformity. The best example of this response to scripture is found in Jesus Christ, who has shown us how to deal with the Word of God and implement it in one's life. Jesus never nullified the Scripture, but he consistently pointed to the Scripture as the authoritative norm for even his words. Jesus also gave us examples of spending time in quiet solitude with the Word of God. This discipline is something we have to regain intentionally in our hectic words. We also can bring scripture to fruition by memorizing it, by singing scripture songs. Often songs will anchor us in the words of scripture, and we will remember a song more than we might remember where the text is found. And sometimes the songs will lift our hearts, will cheer our spirits, or will bring us hope if we are having a difficult time. In Sunday's lesson on page 105, we're going to spend most of our time this morning on this part of the lesson, because it is critical that we understand that the approach we take when we're going to study the Bible is only fruitful for changing our hearts only if we come at the study with humbleness, with the knowledge that we need the Holy Spirit to help us. Think about it. The Bible was written through the Holy Spirit, through humans just like us. So if we want to understand it and have it be clear to us, why would we not need the Holy Spirit? We absolutely need to come to the study of the Bible with the Holy Spirit. The Bible makes it clear that God is patiently reaching out to us in our fallen state. We are spiritually blind, and if left to our own devices, we would not accept the things of God. The person without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, but considers them foolishness and can't understand them because they are only discerned through the Holy Spirit. And we find that in 1 Corinthians 2:14. Even if we were to understand the plain meaning of the words of Scripture clearly, we would have no desire to follow them without the transforming work of the Holy Spirit on our hearts. The Holy Spirit inspired the writers of the Bible to write down the truth that God revealed to them. Word of God is not enough. The Word of God must be embraced in our lives. It must be implemented in our lives. Without the Holy Spirit, we don't have the appreciation that we need to understand that when we study the Bible, that it is there to change us, not only for us to gain knowledge. Studying the Bible with an attitude of wanting to have an argument ready for someone because we want to prove something or we want to make a point is useless. Because unless we come at our study of the Bible with the Holy Spirit, we will have no evidence of faith, no hope, and no love in response to the Word of God. The Holy Spirit enables us to see the spiritual and existential significance of the scriptural word for our lives. Let's turn our Bibles to Ephesians 1:17-19. There we read, "I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance in his holy people, and his incomparably great power for us who believe. The power is the same as the mighty strength." Psalms 119:8 tells us, "I will obey your decrees. Do not utterly forsake me." The Holy Spirit continues to speak to people through the Bible today, making the written Word of God come alive. That Word of God is a word that is sharper than a two-edged sword. In Hebrews 4:12, we read that the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the attitudes and thoughts of the heart. The Bible as a sword cuts through our innermost beings, transforming our lives in the light of Scripture. Several biblical passages point out that the task of the Holy Spirit is to put Jesus Christ in central focus, lifting up the Son of God and what He has done for us. John 15:26 says, "When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who goes out from the Father, He will testify about me." Jesus was busy with healing people and preaching the good news all day long. But He drew His spiritual strength from quality times of solitude in which He would pray and recall the promises of Scripture. Mark tells us that He did that. In our hectic and busy life, we plan to plan deliberately for quiet times with God in which we are uninterrupted, have undisturbed time to reflect on God's Word and pray. Such quiet times will give us strength and spiritual vitality that nothing else can provide. When you are reading the Scripture for pleasure, read less but more of what is important for your spiritual life. When your thoughts begin to wander and drift to unimportant subjects, focus your attention on what God has done for you and practice spiritual concentration on the Word of God. Sometimes singing of a spiritual song or hymn helps to focus our thoughts and even makes it easier for us to remember and memorize words of Scripture. Find the best time of the day so that you can have this precious time with God. So, what do we do with all this information that we have studied this past quarter? What do you want to learn from the way Jesus was familiar with the Scripture and from the way He followed the Word of God? How can Scripture become an integral part of your life and influence the decisions you make?
Sing the song with gladness as your heart.